Good morning.
Oops. Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. I'm Janice Mazur, appearing for the appellant, Bruce Bickoff. Lots of extensive briefing in this case, so I'm not going to reiterate all the facts and theories. I would like to focus on a couple of points that I think are key, and the first would be Wells Fargo's loss of the construction loan agreement, which I do think supports an inference that the agreement was unfavorable.
Why does it support an inference? Your client apparently lost it too,
never had it.
or at least the people that he dealt with, the escrow agents, et cetera.
Right. So and he did make efforts to get it.
Why does it support an inference? Is there any evidence that they lost it after they knew a lawsuit had been filed about it?
Well, not that they knew that a lawsuit had been filed, but I'm glad you asked that question, Your Honor, because the way Wells Fargo has characterized their duty to preserve is that there must be a clear threat of litigation.
And that's to whom do they have a duty to preserve? I'm trying to figure out where. See, normally a duty to preserve something arises when somebody says, you have an important document, and hold on to it because we're going to fight about it, or I have a question about it.
Sure.
From whence does their duty to preserve arise?
Well, that's a good question. I would say at the very latest.
Good answer.
Right, at the very latest, I think they were on notice that there was a serious dispute that reasonably could lead to litigation in April of 2010. At that point, this was after.
Assuming that's right.
Right.
Is there any evidence that this was? There's no evidence of destruction here. They just can't find it.
When
was it lost? Was it lost before the duty arose or after the duty arose?
Well, that's another good question. What Wells Fargo
says. I'm doing
says,
really well with
you're
you.
You're doing
this
great. What Wells Fargo says is that it was lost somewhere between 2007 and 2011. Well, that's a pretty broad spectrum, and it really creates an impossible burden for my client. Because he never had possession of it. He has no way of knowing when they lost it. But so I think that brings
us. But is it their fault that he never had possession of it? That's my problem.
I think it is. He signed all the documents, as I remember, with the title company.
Right.
And there's no dispute that the agreement was there at
right,
that
and the
time.
Title company didn't give him copies of the agreement.
He asked for them that day.
So why is it Wells Fargo's fault that the title company didn't
give him?
Because
then he went back to Mr. Ostov, who was the agent who was, you know, promoted this and worked with him through all course of it and asked for the documents. He went to a second place, too. He went to the title company. They said he had to go to a different office, which I think was the
Wells
Fargo office.
Did he immediately approach Wells Fargo and say, well, wait a minute, this company really messed up. I need to have a copy of its pretty big loan.
Well, you know, I think he made a significant.
Tell me when he made that significant effort.
He did it immediately after it was signed. Then he did it again the next day
with
the title company, and then with another office. And I think it was a Wells Fargo office. They told him to go to the different office.
Yeah. See, I thought the record didn't, and maybe it's not important, but I thought the record didn't disclosed that Wells Fargo was actually asked for this document until the dispute began.
Well, and then in 2010, certainly he did ask for it again.
So is there any evidence that he asked Wells Fargo for the document before 2000?
I believe he asked Mr. Ostrom, and I'll try to look that up when counsel speaks.
All right, so there's a missing piece of evidence in this case.
And it's a key piece of evidence.
And the court basically let in the exemplar. What evidence is there in the record that shows that permanent financing was guaranteed?
Well,
the exemplar doesn't show it. That's not usually how these construction loans work. So what evidence is in the record I can look to?
Right. Well, first we would argue that the exemplar, there's tribal issues of fact as to whether that exemplar was consistent with the document he signed. I know the Wells Fargo person most knowledgeable said that she had never seen the document that he signed.
I'm trying to refocus you away from that onto the affirmative evidence in the record that shows that permanent financing was guaranteed.
You say permanent financing was promised. Tell me what evidence, tell Judge Wynn, what evidence in the record shows that.
Okay, well, I think that the clearest way to look at it is the representations that were made going to the causes of action.
Well, except I've looked at what he said. Your client says the document referenced permanent financing. Mm-hmm. The exemplar references permanent financing, too. And then he says, I wouldn't have signed it had I not thought it gave me. That's not really testimony that the document has a promised and permanent financing. So tell me where else in the record.
Well,
just let me finish. Tell me where else in the record there's evidence that created a triable issue of fact on this.
Well, this loan was marketed specifically as One loan with two closings, and he worked very closely with the expert.
Well, but everybody agrees. It's not disputed in this case that this loan is designed to let you get permanent financing at the end of it. The question is whether it's promised. Mm-hmm. And so tell me what evidence in the record is there is that Wells Fargo promised your client permanent financing.
Mr. Ostrom told Mr. Bickoff when the conditional letter came in, you are approved for permanent financing.
He was. Everybody agrees that the approval had been made. Mm-hmm. The question is whether or not he was promised that he would receive permanent financing.
Right. Well, I think that he justifiably relied on the representations that were made by the representatives of the bank saying that this was going to be permanent financing. This is the way they marketed it to him. They told him that it's going to roll over. In fact, there's an email in there. Let me see if I can find the page for you. There's an email from Ms. Hansen, ER 61, that says the construction loan is going to roll into permanent financing. And that was back in May 2007, right at the very beginning.
Can I ask you a different question? The district judge, Judge Benitez, said, you haven't shown any damages. And you never proffered any evidence that, in effect, had you received the permanent loan, you would have been able to pay it off. What do we do with that?
I think the judge was mistaken on that, Your Honor. And I think
what was your evidence of damages?
Well, there was lots of evidence that there was equity in the property over and above the amount that the foreclosure.
Well, but that's not the damage question. The damage question is: would your client have still been foreclosed had he received a permanent loan? And is there any evidence that he could have paid off the permanent loan? That he had the ability to? I mean, if there was equity in the property, after all, you could go to anybody and borrow against
it.
No evidence of that either.
Right. Well, I think what we have to look at is taking a bigger picture view of this, and that is what was going on during this time period. He got the approval for the loan in 2007, spending a lot of money, you know.
The market crashed,
and suddenly we've got this, you know, enormous, you know,
expenditure. So it leads to the question, had your client gotten a permanent loan in the inflated amount because the construction loan obviously was not what the property was worth.
Right.
Would he have been better off?
Well, sure. I think. I mean, there's nothing in the record to suggest that he.
But there's nothing in the record at all. That's my problem. So what we have here is a construction loan made at the time when the market's good.
Mm-hmm.
The market crashes, and your client doesn't get a permanent loan when the market crashes. The permanent loan would be in the amount of the construction loan. Obviously.
Right.
And much higher than what the property is worth. Mm-hmm. So the question is, how was your client hurt by not getting the permanent loan?
Well, for one thing, he was unable to sell.
It has equity, you know, later, but...
Right. But he was unable to sell the property once they put a notice of default on him.
But if he would have sold the property subject to a permanent loan, wouldn't he? And the property was worth less than the loan amount at the time.
No, the property was worth more than the loan
amount. At the time that your client should have gotten the permanent loan?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Where's that in the record? In other words, your argument is at some point in time he should have gotten a permanent loan.
Right.
So what's the argument in the record of the property value at that point in time? Not today or...
Right. Well, he had two offers at the time, you know, close thereafter for $4.4 million and $4.9 million, which was well above the amount that they did the foreclosure for. So the fact that there was two offers for that amount of money would indicate that, you know,
Not when the foreclosure was done, at the time the loan was supposed to be made. The foreclosure didn't occur until 2 years later.
Well, the estimate...
And the market went back up. So the question is, at the time the loan was made...
Right.
If the property was worth less than the loan amount, what good would the permanent loan have done your client?
Well, I don't think the property was worth less than.
Is there an indication in the record, in ER site, that you can point us to that would tell us the answer?
I think that there is, Your Honor, and I will try to find that for you. I know there was lots of evidence of estimates. There was an appraisal
at the time of foreclosure.
Yeah, but I'm not sure exactly. I don't know if I have an exact date of when the foreclosure was, but there was certainly estimates. I know Mr. Ostrom had valued the property, thought it would be worth about $8 million. That was early on. And
we're just looking for an ER site, and your time is running short. Do you want to save the rest of it?
Yes, I will. Thank you, Your Honor.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, Robert Little on behalf of Wells Fargo. What drives the vast majority of Bickoff's appeal is the contention that he was entitled to an adverse inference that guaranteed him permanent loan financing. This permanent loan financing guarantee existed regardless of how much money he had in the bank, regardless of the appraisal of the property.
Well, there was a commitment letter that seemed to indicate that if he'd managed to build his house within 12 months and he'd and sought permanent financing, he would have gotten it then, wouldn't he?
That is correct, Your Honor.
So that wouldn't have mattered what his financial situation was at the end of the 12 months. It would have only, he would have gotten the loan.
That is correct. Within the 12 months, yes. Outside of the 12 months, no, because too many things can happen. Income can go up and down. Bank accounts can go up and down. There can be adverse impact on a person's income, their assets, their ability to repay.
Did anybody say any of this to Mr. Ostrom, or did they write him emails? For instance, the one that's at 2ER61, there are two loans for a construction loan, one for the construction phase and one when the loan rolls to permanent financing. And for each phase, there are separate set of disclosures. The rolls to permanent financing doesn't suggest a change in circumstance, does it?
Within 12 months. After 12 months, Your Honor, the borrower must requalify for that loan.
Tell me, that's in the exemplar? Where is that? Where do we find that there, the borrower must requalify?
Bottom left-hand corner of SER 149.
The exemplar.
No, SER 149, Your Honor, is the plain language of the marketing materials in the exemplar. There is no reference to permanent loan financing.
So the marketing materials which Mr. Bickoff got said you got a year.
12 months, Your Honor. And
what evidence is there that he got those marketing materials?
He claims that he did not get those marketing materials.
You had marketing materials that said that. But there's no evidence that he saw them.
That it, Your Honor, he denies that he saw them. That is
okay.
Correct.
So tell me what evidence there is that he knew when he signed up for this loan. That everybody agrees you promised permanent financing. The question is whether that promise, in effect, expired after a year.
After 12 months, yes, Your Honor.
That's a year?
I agree, Your Honor, yes.
Okay, so tell me what evidence there was that was communicated to him. He says Mr. Ostrom said, don't worry, this rolls over into permanent financing. And truth is, it does, if it happens within a year. So tell me what his misunderstanding, if there was one, seems to be that he had more than a year. What's the evidence of what he knew about this one-year limit?
The note, the deed of trust, the CLA with the integration clause, or the construction loan agreement, I should say, with the integration clause.
Well, the note is due in a year, right?
The construction loan, Your Honor, is due in 12 months.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
But you were right. I'll use 12 months. You prepared to say 12 months.
It's all right. And I misspoke, Your Honor. The construction loan was due after 2 years, originated in October of 2007.
Well, see, that's part of my problem. The construction loan is due in 2 years, but your promise to roll into permanent financing is in a year. And Mr. Ostrom is alleged to have said, we're at summary judgment, don't worry, you're guaranteed permanent financing. It'll roll over. So the question is, what evidence is there that this guy knew that it only rolled over within a year? The note is dated after the year. Is there anything else that he saw, that we know that he saw or signed, that says he only has a year?
The program disclosure that he signed at the time the loan originated specifically said 12 months.
Tell me what the SER reference to that is.
The program disclosure, Your Honor, may I step to the record?
Yeah, it's in the record?
Yes, Your Honor.
And if you don't have the reference right now, that's fine. I can find it. And the record is that he signed the program disclosure, which said you're promised this within a year, but not after that.
His signature is on the program disclosure, and there is a provision in the program disclosure which says that that the credit approval documents are good for 12 months. The same is true of the loan commitment letter, which also names various conditions that needed to be satisfied in order for him to qualify for permanent loan finance. And I think that the most important piece of evidence, or one piece of evidence, that there was no such unconditional loan guarantee or permanent loan financing guarantee, Your Honor, is at SER 175 to 176. And that is the letter of Jamie Stewart, his own attorney, and his wife, ex-wife, who specifically in that letter indicates that she is aware that he is not guaranteed permanent loan financing unless he has a significant amount of funds in the bank. So here we have his own attorney who said she had met with Mr. Ostrom several times. He disagrees in his declaration in opposition to summary judgment.
No, but we're at summary judgment. I understand you have a powerful case. The question is whether you have enough of a case. They have enough of a case to get to a jury. And so I'm looking at the program disclosure. It's at SER, it's WF00058. So tell me where it says.
SER, Your Honor.
I'm looking at, it's a Wells Fargo, it's marked as, maybe it's 0099, I can't tell. But I've got it in front of me. Tell me where it says the promise only lasts for a year.
Your Honor, may we please get on the same page, just the bottom right-hand corner?
ER 99.
Thank you,
Your Honor. ER 99, I'm sorry. It's not your fault, but my table of contents thing is over the ER number, so I can't read it.
Thank you, Your Honor. And on ER 99 at sentence 5, it specifically says the terms of your permanent loan shall float until you lock in an interest rate and points. And at paragraph 8,
that doesn't talk about a year.
It does not talk about the 12 months. You're correct, Your Honor, but it specifically says that the term shall float. In other words, that there is...
That just may be, we'll give you a loan, but we can't promise the terms. Tell me where, I mean, I'm looking in this document, and I don't see the words either 12 months or 1 year in them. So tell me where they are.
In the program disclosure, there's this, the terms shall float. In the...
I'm asking a very specific question.
Okay.
There's something in here that says, our commitment to give you a permanent loan lasts only 1 year.
That isn't in this specific document.
What other specific document in the record is it in?
In the loan commitment letter, there is a specific reference
and
to...
And that's ER...
The credit documents being good for 12 months.
Tell me the ER reference.
I'm finding it, Your Honor.
I'm looking at frequently asked questions.
I'm looking, for example, Your Honor, at ER 176 to 177.
Okay.
In ER 176 to 177, at the bottom, there are several enumerated conditions. There's 10 of them, and 10 has 4 subparts.
Okay, now this is not a document he signed.
That is correct, Your Honor.
And what's the evidence? He denies seeing it.
No, Your Honor. He actually, his third cause of action, he brought a claim for breach of this agreement, claiming that this was a contract and that Wells Fargo had breached it. On appeal, he takes a completely different tact and he says that this is not a binding contract.
But the evidence, tell me what evidence again, maybe we crossed each other in our question. Tell me what evidence there is does he admit seeing this document? I know he makes inconsistent claims based on it. Tell me what evidence there is that he saw it.
Oh, Your Honor, well, he relied on it because he sued on it.
Well, his lawyers may have seen it. Tell me what evidence there is in this record that he saw it. Not signed, right?
No, Mark Ostrom signed it in May of 07. He sued on it in 2010.
No deposition questioning or declaration that references it specifically. Is that what you're saying?
I believe that it's referenced in his declaration in opposition to summary judgment. In order to provide the site, Your Honor, I would need to submit a letter.
Right. That's what we're struggling. We're asking for help with going through the record, but we've taken you over your time. I don't know if you have any questions. Judge Eaton, do you have any questions?
No.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Honors.
I'll be very brief. In response to the court's questions about the damages, I'm looking at the reply brief on page 14 that says that there was testimony that the in 2010 in 2010 the property was appraised for I think
Default was in 2009.
Pardon me?
When was the default on the construction?
2010.
2009. The 2007. It's a 2007 transaction with a two-year loan.
But it was extended.
Loan was extended for a year?
Right. It was extended to, I believe, February or March of 2010.
Okay.
And April was when the default was taken, the original notice of default. And so, you know what? I'm on my wrong. I said reply brief, too. I don't think it is page 14, but I did see it. So there is evidence that in 2010, the property was appraised at far in excess of what the amount of the loan was. Here it is. Sorry, page 24 of the reply brief. As far as the commitment letter with the 12-month statement, I don't recall that there was any evidence either way that Mr. Bickoff saw that. That's in the record. I know that it's argued that he relied on it, and I could be mistaken on that.
If he's arguing he relied on it, then he...
His lawyer, right, his lawyers are saying that it was a breach, but, you know, I don't know.
What does his declaration say?
I don't recall whether it specifically said he saw that. Obviously, he signed a lot of documents. That one wasn't signed, but one would suppose that it was within the documents signed by the title company, but I can't guarantee that. I do think that the 12-month statement is certainly ambiguous. What the document says is that the credit approval is good for 12 months from the construction closing. It doesn't say from the construction loan closing. So that certainly could be interpreted to mean, you know, after the construction is done, then you have 12 months after that, and I think that it was entirely unclear what that meant, and I think there's testimony that Mr. Bickoff believed that some of those conditions there were the conditions to get the construction loan, and that they wouldn't have funded it at all if those conditions hadn't been met. It was not clear to him that these were conditions that were supposed to be met after the construction was complete.
You're well over time, so unless Judge Hurwitz has a specific question, Judge Eaton? All right.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you very much for your arguments, both sides. I'll submit the matter for decision.
Thank you so much for coming out today to the first of this series of our planned programs. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out today to the first of this series of our planned programs. Last year, we did four immigration-specific training programs and then a habeas corpus one, and we did them in the locations where we tend to go more, San Francisco, Pasadena, Seattle, Phoenix. So this year we decided that we were going to switch it up and first of all do a more general, in terms of subject matter, appellate advocacy program. But we also decided that we really wanted to come out to visit some of the places that we don't get to as often. So this is our first one. It's my first time in Billings and it's great to be here. My name is Susan Gelmis and I'm the Chief Deputy Clerk for Operations at the Ninth Circuit based in San Francisco. And we have four court staff plus our chief judge, as well as some local and a couple of not as local practitioners who are going to be speaking with you today about practicing appellate law in the Ninth Circuit in particular. And So we're delighted to be here and to be kicking off the series. In 2 weeks, we're going to do slightly shortened but similar versions of this in Spokane and Boise. And then we'll have some more locations early next year. Before we get started, I do want to thank the District Court in Billings for hosting us and providing us with great space and this beautiful outside area. And I want to also thank the Montana Federal Bar Association for co-sponsoring this event with us, with our attorney admission fund is how we're sponsoring our end of it. And I want to thank our Ninth Circuit appellate lawyer representatives who helped us plan these programs. And two of them are actually here and participating in this program. Dan Donovan from Great Falls is our Montana appellate lawyer rep. And Leonard Feldman from Seattle is one of our Washington lawyer reps. And so they came a distance as well to come in and be part of this. And of course, we will have a little while later our locally based Chief Judge Thomas, and he will be speaking with you as well. So all of the program materials and the PowerPoints and handouts and things that may not have made it into the handouts are actually posted on our website, and I want to show you, this is an example of, this is our website live. So, and we're going to refer to this website several times during the course of the day. But I wanted to specifically show you, first of all, you can see we are live streaming right there at that link. So anybody out there who, hopefully my dad is watching, happy birthday, Dad. Anyway, so that's where you can always find live streaming of our oral arguments. And we've just last week added the words and events because we're starting to have more and more of those that are live streamed. And then later we post all of our archived audio and video there. But if you go to this legal guides section here, you will see appellate advocacy program. And that will show you, here's the Billings one where we are today, and all the materials are up there. We also have just the agenda so far for the next two, but we'll be posting materials there as well. When this is done, we're going to post the video of this program up here with these materials as well. So the idea is to make this as accessible to people as possible, especially when we're doing it in places like Montana, where it's, you know, really very large geographic area. Not everybody can get there in person. So let's see. The only other, there's also materials that are in a binder or a bound set that you got on your way in, hopefully. Those of you who are going to be getting CLE credit from the Montana Bar, just make sure you send in that form and that you have signed in with our staff out there with Meredith. And the only other thing logistically I want to say is that the restrooms are out there and to the left. We will take a couple of breaks. We will be providing lunch out in the large area there. You can take it outside or not. And then there's going to be a reception at the end of the program this afternoon. So I'm going to get us started with sort of an overview. Let me see if I can pull up my thing here. There we go. Excellent. So this is a photo of our San Francisco courthouse. Those of you, which is the headquarters of the Ninth Circuit, those of you who have not been there, the courthouse is an amazing, beautiful monument of testament to what public buildings used to be and should be. Unfortunately, it's in a really, really sketchy neighborhood, but it is really a tremendous honor to work in that building, and I certainly encourage anybody who gets the chance to be down that way to come and get a tour. It's quite wonderful. But we have courthouses also in Pasadena and Seattle and Portland, and then we hold oral arguments at various times in usually district courts or law schools in other locations. So, but that's the the headquarters. This is a photo of our current court, including our senior judges, or most of them. We have 29 active judgeships. We currently have 4 vacancies and another one coming in March. Judge Tallman has announced that he's going to go senior in March. So we are really struggling with not having enough judges right now. Thankfully, many of our senior judges work really, really hard, and they don't have to at all. They're working essentially for free. We have 18 senior judges right now, and many of them are have active caseloads. We also have a number of our active judges who are eligible for senior status. They just haven't taken it. So we are, you know, hoping to get some more judges. Oops, that was not right. Sorry. I'm using the mouse and not this. Okay. So, I'm in the clerk's office, numbers, I do numbers. Hopefully this will give you an idea of what our caseload is like and where it comes from and what kinds of cases we have and sort of where they are in the system. This is a photo of our courtroom one, which is our en banc courtroom in San Francisco. And just liked having that there. So here's, so all of the statistics other than the ones that I say were like as of September 18th, all of them are the 12-month period ending June 30th of this year, just so you know. So this is a comparison of case filings, that's the orange, in the 5th, 1st, and 9th Circuit, cases terminated in those circuits, and pending cases. You can see the 1st Circuit is the smallest. We get that many appeals, like, in a month. And the 5th is the next largest to us. Which is still, you know, not really anywhere close. We are, you can see that our green outflanks our orange, which means we are terminating more cases than we're getting. But because we had this huge, huge influx about 10 or 11 years ago in immigration cases, when the post 9/11, the agency decided that they needed to streamline their process and get all their backlog out, and it all ended up on us and the Second Circuit. We, between the two circuits, we have almost all the immigration caseload. And we have a huge share of that. So we got really backlogged. We didn't get extra judgeships to go with that. We've had one additional judgeship given to us since the early 1980s. So we've, you know, got snowed under. We are pulling out of that by getting rid of more, you know, deciding more cases every year than we're taking in. But we're still chipping away at that backlog. And so you can see that's the blue, is the backlog. And of course, as we get better and better at chipping away at the backlog, our processing times look worse and worse because we are getting rid of our oldest cases. So that's just the way it goes. This shows you where our pending cases are as of a week ago or so. The green, the largest portion of them, we call that not fully briefed. That's a slight misnomer because it doesn't, a lot of those cases will never get briefed. That includes all of the original proceedings, like mandamus petitions, that are just going to be decided on the petition, or the habeas corpus appeals that need a certificate of appealability. Only 10% of those are granted, and so the 90% of certificate of appealability requests that are denied, that's the end of the case. It doesn't get briefed after that. There are cases that will be dismissed along the way for a large variety of reasons, including mediation, and you'll hear about that a little later, but also including failure to file a brief or pay the fees or people just changing their minds or motions that are granted, dispositive motions for a variety of reasons that are granted. You'll hear more about that at the next panel. So that 53% includes all of those cases that are actually going to go away before they ever get fully briefed. But it also includes cases that are in the process of briefing and just haven't been fully briefed yet. Then you see the blue are, the 12% blue are assigned to merits panels. They are either assigned but haven't been argued and submitted yet, or they have been argued and submitted and haven't been decided yet. Our judges are very good about deciding cases fairly quickly after they get argued and submitted. But keep in mind that we're calendaring them 4 months before the argument date. So it's assigned to a merits panel 4 months before they can even try to decide it. So you have to build that in. Then you have the 5%. Oh, those are actually the certificate of appealability pending, is that little yellow 5%. We break those out. The other 12% is our biggest challenge. Those are the cases that are fully briefed and need an argument panel, and they're just waiting in line because we don't have enough judges. That's the bottom line. We're trying to get those onto calendars as fast as we can, and they just don't have enough judges. The 18% are awaiting our merits panels that we do internally without argument, and those are worked up and presented by central staff attorneys to judges on a different track. And so those, we also have a backlog of those, but it's not for the same reasons, because that's a huge part of our caseload, is those screening cases. So I want to show you on the next slide the exact same thing, but for the Montana cases. So we have 100 and something. I wrote it down somewhere, but not on these notes, unfortunately. These are our total Montana caseload at the same date that the previous slide was. 6% are 10 COA, Certificate of Appealability, pending. The 21% assigned to merits panels are 34 cases. The 13% that are awaiting calendar, 22 cases. The 12% awaiting screening, 19 cases, and then the 48%. So of our 12,000 or so pending appeals, 150 of them or so are from Montana at this moment. And this is sort of the breakdown. It's a similar breakdown in terms of percentages. It's just the numbers are much, much smaller. And I just thought that was an interesting thing to see. In terms of where our appeals come from, you can see that the largest spike here is the Board of Immigration Appeals. That is still our biggest feeder of our caseload. Those are immigration cases coming directly from the agency to the court. The next biggest provider of our caseload is the Central District of California, the CAC that you see down there. This is basically that one figure alone. If you made it its own circuit, just the Central District of California, and included the BIA cases that would be there because of where the petitioners are, that would be the largest circuit in the country. Just saying. As a point of interest. Okay, case types. This is what I thought this was actually the most interesting thing I found when I broke down into the Montana case types versus ours. Sorry, I'm talking too loud. Yep, I get that a lot. Thank you, Kwame. I've never had anyone tell me, speak up. What I get is very gentle, nice, moving it away. So thank you. So the overall case type, this is filings over the 12-month period of what types of cases were they in specific buckets. And then I have on the next slide the filings during that same 12-month period from Montana. And this actually was a very interesting thing for me as someone who sort of likes this stuff to see how those two things differed. So you can see again, 28%, the blue, that's immigration. That is, we had almost 30% of our case filings in that 12-month period were immigration cases. So it's still a humongous part of our caseload. The yellow 15% are habeas corpus, and the light green 8% are the prisoner civil rights, and the 12% gray are criminal. Those three types all involve detained or incarcerated litigants, and so they have statutory priority in calendaring. And I say this because on the next slide is where I found an interesting thing about the Montana cases. The appeals coming from Montana, a larger percentage of them are those three case types combined, the prisoner, incarcerated litigants that have statutory priority for calendaring. So if you look at the 26% orange civil and the 2% dark blue bankruptcy. Those are, of course, the case types that have zero priority for calendaring, unless they're interlocutory or preliminary injunction or something like that. But otherwise, they have zero statutory priority for the most part. And that becomes an issue when we're trying to squeeze a ton of cases onto calendars that are limited. So, because if you look at the next slide, which is the Montana ones, now there's no immigration or agency or bankruptcy cases during that 12-month period that came out of Montana. But 32% compared to 23% overall percent of the cases are prisoner cases, habeas and civil rights, and 34% compared to 12% of the overall caseload are criminal. 34% of our Montana filings during that 12-month period were direct criminal appeals. Those have the highest statutory priority of all. So anyway, that I thought that was an interesting thing that I wouldn't have known without breaking it down for this program, just to see what we had. So please come in. This is another thing, you know, the age of the pending cases. You can see that, you know, the blue is actually cases that have been filed within the last year. So that's good that the blue is the biggest, right? Because we want that to be the biggest. But you'll also see that we have the orange cases that are older than 2 years, cases that were filed more than 2 years ago. We and that can range, you know, in our overall filings from 2 to many years, because some of them are in abeyance for many years. Some of them are cases that the court, at some point during the immigration caseload crisis, the court made a determination for a variety of reasons that it just couldn't possibly keep current with all its cases. And the immigration cases were, there were just too many of them. They didn't want to hear only immigration cases. And they didn't want other cases to be even more sidetracked because of immigration cases. So they basically decided to have a deliberate backlog of one type of, I mean, it was, they were going to have a backlog no matter what. So they said, we're just going to make the immigration cases, that's where the big backlog's going to be. A lot of them went into mediation and other sort of informal held statuses for many years so that they could try to work out other things. So that obviously impacts the age of some of these cases. But if you look at the overall, you know, cases currently pending that are older than 2 years, you'll see there's 2,100 of them circuit-wide, only 10 from Montana. And of the 10 from Montana, two of them are in abeyance. Six of them are awaiting screening, which are mostly the, you know, pro se prisoner cases that have been deemed not to warrant pro bono counsel, or the Social Security cases that, you know, where the law is clear, it's just the records are, you know, they need a lot of workup. One is awaiting assignment to an argument calendar, and one is assigned to an argument calendar. So of the 10 that are older than 2 years, they're, you know, that's the status of them. This is a statistic that we at the court look at a lot and try to keep up with it. And every time we try to, let's get rid of this backlog, and then another one pops up over there. And so we're trying to sort of balance it out all over the place. But that's what that looks like. You can see that 46% of our filings during that 12-month period were pro se litigants. That for many, many, many years, that statistic was actually very steady at about a third of our filings. It was about 33 to 35% over many, many years. In the last 5 years or so, it's gone up sometimes to over 50. This is actually down from 48% the year before. This pro se filings, you know, pro se appeals, it could be anything from, you know, we had all those mortgage crisis cases and, you know, there's always prisoner cases and Social Security cases, and it's just a wide variety of things. But, you know, the economy obviously ebbs and flows with that as well, or it ebbs and flows with the economy. In terms of types of terminations, on the this is cases that are terminated on the merits. And that's a that's an administrative office of the court's term that we have to follow for statistical reporting purposes. So what they mean by that is not cases that were dismissed for lack of jurisdiction, appellate jurisdiction. We dismiss a lot of cases for lack of appellate jurisdiction. Three judges, you know, have to come together and decide that. That's not a termination on the merits. However, a denial or a grant of a mandamus petition or a certificate of appealability denial or any kind of, obviously, something that gets to the merits of an appeal, those are considered to be merits terminations. Only about half, a little over half, of our cases are terminated on the merits. We have a lot of cases that are dismissed by clerk order. Again, mediation or voluntary dismissal or failure to prosecute, remand to the agency, things that the court has delegated to our clerks to be able to do. Those are all procedural terminations, of course, as well as some of the judge terminations are procedural. So if you'll see here, 36%, so sorry, that was the statistic, 36% of our terminations during that 12-month period were procedural, whether it be by clerks or judges. 51% were submitted, either submitted on the briefs by argument panels or submitted to screening panels by staff. And then only 13% of them actually got oral argument. Of the cases that were submitted on the briefs, of course, all of the screening panel cases are submitted on the briefs. That's part of the point. So that's 52% of them. 48% of the cases that were decided on the merits after submission on the briefs, they were argument panels that said, no, we don't need argument. So that's, you know, just because it gets an argument panel doesn't necessarily mean it's going to get argument. This is another way of sort of showing that of the merits terminations total overall, only 22% got argument. And then there's that tiny little sliver that was en banc argument. And you're going to hear a lot more about our en banc process this afternoon at the end of the program. So Ninth Circuit arguments, pretty steady over the many years. They've never been over 2,000 in a year. We're at about 1,500 a year of our total cases get argued. This just shows you how much we rely on our senior and visiting judges. We don't use visiting judges on our staff panels, like our screening and motions panels, but we do use them. We rely on them a lot on our argument panels because we simply don't have enough judges. We also use our senior judges on all of the above, except for en banc. Our senior judges are on every kind of panel. During that 12-month period, 43.2% of our merits terminations involved a senior or visiting judge. 43.2%. Nationally, that number was 26.5%. We simply, I mean, with the vacancies in particular, we just don't have enough judges. So we're very grateful to our senior judges and the visiting judges. Just to show you the reversal rate, we're right in there in the mix with everybody else. We had an overall 10.1% reversal rate during that 12-month period. That Third Circuit one is an anomaly. I don't know what that's about, but it was probably some Johnson-related thing, so I would ignore that. Generally, it's between, you know, 5 and 15% nationally is the average for reversals. Our en banc process, like I said, you're going to hear a lot more about this later. But of the, in 2016, of the 816 petitions for rehearing en banc that we received, only 32 of them even went to a vote, and only 19 of them got enough yes votes to actually go en banc. So it's a tiny percentage of our caseload, but of course a very important part of that. I mean, in terms of what the cases are, they tend to be very important. That's why they go en banc. I always like this one, reversals from the Supreme Court. During the 2016-2017 term, it's all in your perspective, right? They took 8 of our 12,000 cases that we decided during that term, and they affirmed one of them and reversed 7. So you could say that's an 87% reversal rate, which sounds terrible. Although the national average of reversal rate that term was 79%, and four circuits had 100% reversal rates, so we're not that bad. Plus, as some of our judges like to say, getting seven wrong out of 12,000 really isn't so bad, you know, like perspective. So anyway, I love those statistics, because that's one of those, like, statistics, do what you want with them, and you can make something to, you know, fit what you would like it to say. I'm going to very briefly talk about sort of our overall court process. You're going to hear more about that from our next panel, and really from all of our panels. But this is a picture of our Redwood Room, which is really one of the most beautiful historical rooms in the courthouse. So I like to include that in there. Not that we actually in the staff use it for very many things other than parties. And some meetings and, you know, large group meetings, but it is a lovely room, and it's the only one that has an actual working fireplace. We have a lot of fireplaces in the courthouse, but including one in my office, but none of them work. So this is just a sketch that every single new case, almost 12,000 of them filed in the last 12-month period, every single one that comes in the door goes immediately to some part of our staff attorney's office to be reviewed at the outset. Do we have jurisdiction? Have the fees been paid? Is this part of some huge mess that's going to all, you know, a multi-district litigation or something that we need to manage from the outset? Is it a huge multi-defendant criminal appeal that we're going to have to manage from the outset? Is it something that looks clearly foreclosed for whatever reason? Those kinds of things get an initial look right off the bat. And if there seems to be a problem with it, we try to resolve that problem. Or if it seems that it doesn't belong in our court for whatever reason, there's no jurisdiction or it's clearly foreclosed or something, then we will take care of that very quickly. And Allison will tell you more about that at the next panel. But that and the certificates of appealability, which is its own separate group within the staff attorney's office that just deal with the new habeas appeals where the district court has denied such a certificate, and so they can't move forward. They're not even considered an appeal unless our court grants a certificate. And so that is a process that happens at the initial filing. And if they grant one, then they'll set a briefing schedule and it'll go forward like any other appeal. But if they deny it, that's the end of the case. All of our original proceedings, our mandamus petitions, our 1292B petitions, other kinds of permissive requests, second or successive habeas petitions, those are all assigned to staff attorneys at the outset and presented to panels right up front. And the vast majority of them, almost all of them, are decided by those panels, staff panels, right up front. Not meaning panels made up of staff, panels that staff present to. They are Ninth Circuit judges on those panels. But so just with this process alone, a whole lot of cases are going to drop off or be decided before they get any farther. This is sort of a chart that shows you, you know, when we start. The brand new thing is filed. It's going to the Certificate of Appealability group or the motions group. The record piece doesn't mean what it used to. It used to mean we actually had to wait for the district court to send us the physical paper record. We don't need to do that anymore, thank goodness. But we do get the agency record and immigration cases early on so that we can look at that and make sure there's no issues with jurisdiction or whatever. We might